Thank you. I have tasted of freedom. I can go where he's leading, for shackles can hold me no more. I have learned of life's essence, and I stand in his presence and sing with my heart, he is Lord. There are days filled with sorrow and plans for tomorrow, but this is the time I must sing. And I know there's a reason why in his own season God gives me a song I can sing. Keep silent, ye mountains, ye fields and ye fountains, for this is the time I must sing. It's the time to sing praises to the rock of the ages, for this is the time I must sing. If I've seen and I've done, and I've gained and I've won all the good things that life ever brings, still I've tasted enough of life's miracle stuff that forever I'd just have to sing. Keep silent, ye mountains, ye fields and ye fountains, for this is the time I must sing. It's the time to sing praises to the rock of the ages, for this is the time I must sing. If the rocks would cry out, should his praises die out, then the stones must keep silent as long as I've breath for the singing. His praise will keep ringing, and I will keep singing my song. Oh, keep silent, ye mountains, ye fields and ye fountains, for this is the time I must sing. It's the time to sing praises to the rock of the ages, for this is the time I must sing. Keep silent, ye mountains, ye fields and ye fountains, for this is the time I must sing. It's the time to sing praises to the rock of the ages, for this is the time I must sing.
What a great day to rejoice with you as we worship the Lord together. Let's stand and we'll sing our chorus for the month.
We'll sing as you look at the screens.
Walking with Jesus, walking every day, walking all the way. Walking with Jesus, I'm walking with Jesus alone. Walking in the sunlight, walking in the shadows, walking every day, walking all the way, walking in the sunlight, walking in the shadows, I'm walking with Jesus alone.
Go and turn to page 598. Page 598, we're saying Standing on the Promises, page 598. Sing it out on that first verse.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
On that second.
Standing on the promises that cannot fail. Will the howling terms of doubt and fear assail? By the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
On that last.
Standing on the promises, I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Please say our monthly verse together with me. Isaiah 8, 12, and 13. Neither fear ye their fear, nor be afraid. Sanctify the Lord of hosts himself, and let him be your fear, and let him be your dread. Isaiah 8 and 12 and 13. Thank you. Please greet each other this morning. Thank you. You may be seated. We have GPS meetings following our evening service tonight. We'll all be back at 6 o'clock for our evening service, and then we'll have GPS tonight. And we want to remind you to bring in names and addresses of people that you would like to invite to our 9/11 ceremony. So please be thinking about that and working on that this afternoon. Come prepared for that this evening, please. And we hope that we'll have lots to go off of tonight. So thank you for helping us with that. And then there will be there is a sign-up sheet on the back usher's table for the Primetimers trip this week. That'll be on Tuesday the 23rd. That's next week, on the 23rd. And so if you're planning on going on that trip, we need you to sign up today. That's for all of our prime timers, as well as our leadership team and staff. And so please, if you're planning on going, sign up today. We need to make sure we have all that are going so that we can make arrangements for that. So today will be the final day for signing up on that. Tomorrow morning, we'll meet at Matt's for all of our men at 8 o'clock. If you're able to come and join us for breakfast, all of our men are welcome to come at 8 o'clock to Matt's and Ross Common. And then next Sunday, we'll have a quarterly church business meeting following our evening service. And so our members are encouraged, please, to be here for that following the service next Sunday night. And then we'll have our annual Sweet Corn Fellowship, and that is a great time of fellowship, and we look forward to that next Sunday night as well. And then on Monday the 23rd, Primetimers, you'll be going on that trip. You'll leave at 9:30 from the church, and so please plan to be with us if you're able to. That'll be on Monday the 23rd. We'll leave at 9:30 from the church. And then on Tuesday the 24th, school season begins, as our ICS parent-teacher meeting will be at 6 o'clock that evening. That will also be our midweek service that night. And so, again, we want all of our parents and students to be here for that meeting on the 24th, and then our midweek service will be at 7 o'clock that evening. So please don't forget about that. Just a reminder that on the 27th, we'll have a baby shower for Erica Breedlove. That will be at 6 o'clock. And so we want you to make sure you have that on your calendar, ladies, for that evening on the 27th. That's a Friday evening.
Take your scriptures this morning. We'll be in Matthew chapter 11. Matthew chapter 11, we'll just read one verse, and then we're going to find our way over to James chapter 3. So Matthew chapter 11, we'll begin reading and just read verse 30, and then James chapter 3, verse 17. James chapter 3, verse 17. We're going to start in Matthew chapter 11. Matthew chapter 11. And verse 30, Matthew chapter 11, verse 30. The Bible reads, "For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." James chapter 3, James chapter 3, verse 17. James chapter 3, verse 17. Scripture reading here, verse 17. "But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy." May God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we again thank you and praise your name this morning as we meet together around your word. I pray, Lord, as you be pleased with our worship and song, and now you be pleased with our worship as our offering. Lord, I pray that you'd bless. In Jesus' name, amen.
Student Church dismissed. Go ahead and stand with us. We're going to turn to page 507. Page 507, His Way With Thee, page 507. Sing it out in that first verse.
Would you live for Jesus and be always pure and good? Would you walk with Him within the narrow road? Would you have Him bear your burden, carry all your load? Let Him have His way with thee. His power can make you what you ought to be. His blood can cleanse your heart and make you free. His love can fill your soul and you will see. 'Twas best for Him to have His way with thee.
Great singing, you may be seated.
Well, we want to welcome our live stream family today, and I have a hunch that we know a few of the folks who are watching by live stream. And if we have never had the chance of meeting you in person, we hope that you will come visit us sometime here at Emmanuel. Others of you who we do know who are on vacation, we welcome you this morning and thank you for taking time to worship with us. For all of us who are gathered here today, this is a great day. We're halfway through August. God has protected us. He has taken care of us. He has given us safe passage. He's given a wonderful summer for the ministries of our church, as well as the ministries that we love and support, like Camp Kobiak, Pensacola Christian College's Teen Extreme. I'm thinking of camp down at the Wilds and other Christian camps like the Bill Rice Ranch, literally all over the country. And now as things seem to get a little weird all of a sudden, we want to find a way this morning that God can help us to continue to be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. You know, life really seems anything but easy right now. I've often said that no one should want to become the President of the United States ever, not ever, because the pressure of the office is something that is almost unbearable in the complexities that our world faces. And so when I think of what we see around the world, I think of a lot of things I am glad that God did not choose for me to do. On the other hand, I also have to realize that if God had chosen me or God had chosen you, He would also equip us to do the work, whatever that work be. So that's good news, because if we follow the Lord, He will always make a way. And by the way, His path is not one that is made to cause us to stumble or fall. His path is one that makes us to go forward in victory for Him. You know, the life that God intended for us is not easy. Not easy in the fact that some people want to live a life where nothing adverse ever happens to them. They want life where their car is always parked at the corner of Hunky and Dory Streets. Everything is awesome. It's just not the way life is. And what God offers to us through the prophets, and of course here in the New Testament as we're looking at it, God offers for us to exchange the yokes of iron. Whenever I think of iron, I think of that iron yoke. You could probably think in 2021 of what the iron curtain still represents around the world. And when we think of that oppression, when we think of that heaviness and that hurt, we are given an opportunity to shake off those yokes of iron and exchange them for a yoke that, as Aaron read this morning, is easy. And then, of course, when we look in James chapter 3, we see that the wisdom that is from above is easy to be entreated. So what is this easy life that God offers to us? I mentioned yesterday in an email we sent church-wide, and if you did not receive that email, for some reason you're not on our church email list, I talked about the stimulus, didn't I? And when I talked about the stimulus, I talked about the fact that last year most Americans received a stimulus check, or two, or three, or how many ever there were. And so when you think about the stimulus, you think about the richness or the benefit, you think about a credit. And I think of that spiritually because God brings that to every believer. And I see in this passage a great opportunity to choose to do life God's way instead of our own way. And you know, isn't it amazing? We think we know best, and yet we keep coming up short. You see, the Bible says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." We most and appropriately bring that verse into context when we are witnessing or soul winning to someone. But the truth of the matter is, the verse can stand on its own. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I like how the description of it I heard from a Bible teacher in college who said that it's as if we were taking and we were shooting an arrow as far as we could, and yet it falls short of the target. In other words, we miss the mark. I could rear back and try to jump from the north rim of the Grand Canyon to the south rim of the Grand Canyon. I could go back 50 feet, get in a full dead run, and I could probably go about, 12 feet and then perish at the bottom of the canyon. But just like all of our generations seem to be, I know better. So I'm going to wear better shoes, and I'm going to go back 50 feet. I've got technology on my side. I've got better conditioning. I know better. I'm going to jump that canyon. So instead of going back 15 feet in work boots, I go back 50 feet in the best tennis shoes money can buy, and I full run, and I make it. I made an extra 7 feet. But I still perished at the bottom. You see, that's what happens in life because all of us are sinners. We come short of the glory of God. And while some people may be impeccably well-versed in their lives and they may shun evil things and they may do good deeds, even with their best, they're still going to fall short. Everyone does. But that's the solution we find here with this 21 easy way. How many of you believe, like I do, because I've seen it in my own life, it's so easy to give it to the Lord for 1 or 2 or 3 days. And then by day 4 and 5, you're taking it back. And then remember, we talked about the only ammo Satan has in his weapon is deceit, lies. So what does the devil do? We try for 3 days and then we stumble. And the devil comes to us and says, "See, I told you, you can't do it. God is too far above you. You will never be able to achieve what he has for you. So quit trying and just live life the way you know to live it." You got to shake off those lies and that deception of Lucifer. You get it right with God, you get back up, and you keep moving forward for God's glory. Your wives depend on it, men. Your husbands depend on it, ladies. Your children depend on it, parents. Our church depends on it, members and attenders. God depends on it, pastor. The work of the ministry depends on it. We get back up and we keep going. But pastor, it's so hard. Life is hard when it's done on your terms. Things become far easier when they're done on God's. Because when God is in charge, he also promised to be our guide. I like how the psalmist said it. He will be our guide even unto death. When one of our members passed away recently, I had the privilege of being there when no one else was. And I knew that they passed and graduated to heaven in perfect peace just by how they left this life. You know, there's something special about being a believer, isn't there? And this morning I want to explore with you how we can avoid the devil's delusion of defeat and deceit. How we can quit finding that just giving up is more enticing to us than going on. Because God has called us to serve and to live a life. And in these amazing verses that we've read this morning, Jesus says, "My yoke is easy." And James said, the wisdom that is from above is easy to be entreated. Father, help us as we look at the Word this morning. I pray that you will inspire us from the Word, and I pray that you will help us to live in a way that pleases you. Amen.
God said there's coming a day when I'm going to shake the world, but some things will not be shaken. Some things remain. In other words, there's coming a time when the world will be pressed and there'll be no way out. Those times come in your life, in your home. Tension, friction, financial trouble. You're pressed and there doesn't seem to be a way out. There is an answer. There is a way. Jesus said, I am the way. But in the midst of all this changing, there are some things that never change. Think of it a moment. What never changes? The nature of God doesn't change. God hasn't changed. He hasn't changed to adapt himself to our generation. God is unchanging. I am the Lord God, I change not. God is unchanging in his holiness. We're all guilty of coming short of God's holy requirements. And we're all sinners, and we're all in need of the grace and mercy of God. And that's why the Lord Jesus came and died on the cross. He died for your sins. He died for mine. And God took your sins and laid them on Christ. God changes not in his holiness. And let me tell you, because he is our holy God, he is also unchanging in his judgment. There is a judgment day coming. Our God is a consuming fire. The Bible is filled with stories of judgment. Our Lord talked more about hell than he did heaven. There is a day of judgment coming. God is a holy God, and you and I are going to stand there. And when I stand there, I'm not going to ask for justice. I'm going to ask for mercy. I need mercy. I need the grace of God. I need the forgiveness of God. And I want to tell you a wonderful thing. God loves you, and he offers you tonight forgiveness, and he offers you mercy. God can forgive every sin you've ever committed. God can wipe the slate clean because of Christ. Not because you deserve it. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. You can't work your way to heaven. You can't buy your way to heaven. God is unchanging. He's unchanging in his love. God loves you. That's the most wonderful thing to go to bed with at night, to know that God loves me. God forgives me. God is interested in me. But I must receive him. Secondly, the word of God does not change. The grass withereth and the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever. I settled that a long time ago. There are a lot of things in this Bible I don't understand. There are questions you could ask me that I cannot answer. I don't know all the answers in this book. How can a finite mind like mine comprehend the infinite? I cannot. So one day I opened the Bible and I said, oh Lord, I accept this as your word by faith. And that settled it from that moment on. When I quote the scriptures, I know that I'm quoting the word of God. It's a living word. And lastly, the way of salvation has not changed. All these centuries, the way to the kingdom of God is exactly the same. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. He will never change. But you must change.
And this morning, the concept that we hear from Dr. Billy Graham, who has been with the Lord now for many years, is not only an understanding that I wish more commencement ceremonies had speakers like that, but I feel that we have allowed those yokes of wood that Jesus promised us, a lighter, an easier burden, we've exchanged it for those yokes of iron, and it comes back to what he said, because we choose to do things our way instead of his. So this morning, let's take the second part of this 21 easy concept, this principle that we find in the Word that I've made adaptable for 2021, and let's be able to employ that into our lives. Let's go to the passages, if you will. We are looking, first of all, at Matthew chapter 11. In Matthew chapter 11, we will find our usage of the Greek word here for the word easy. Jesus says, "For my yoke is easy." Now, when Jesus is talking about this, I think it's important that we understand that when we look at this word, it's krastos. When we look at the word and understand it, we also, because we have God's preserved word in our English language, we want to go to the other passages and see, because we have two major words used for the word easy in the New Testament. It occurs about seven times in about six different passages, but let's go to James and let me show you that one, and then I want to run with this and let the Lord speak to all of us. James chapter 3, in verse 17, we understand that Jesus Christ personifies wisdom. Do you believe that? I certainly believe that. Jesus Christ is the essence of true wisdom. And for example, I'm using a Ryrie Study Bible, and at verse 13, there is a major heading that is the seventh great principle that we find in the book of James, and it talks about true wisdom. And when you look at true wisdom in verse 17, the Bible says, "But the wisdom that is from above," that is a heavenly wisdom, that is the wisdom of the Lord, "is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated." In other words, it's going to explain it now. So what does it mean, easy to be entreated? What is it persuaded by? What is the outcome of what is happening when this wisdom comes into you and I through the Holy Spirit by way of God's word and our obedience to him? We become people who are living lives as this wisdom is, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality, and probably the paramount of this, because the world is watching, without hypocrisy. The world just needs to see genuineness in the lives of believers, for then they would begin to crave the change, the difference that Christ has made in us. So when we look at the passage here, we are really seeing two major words. Now the first word, krastos, comes from another more complex word, and then the word used in James, eupitethes, is an interesting and amazing word. And I find that when you look at this, you will see, as I look in the passage, the word easy, it's something that's useful. It's something that's employable. You can employ it. You can put it into practice. It's something that is already furnished. And when we are persuaded by the Spirit of God, through the Word of God, into our hearts by obedience, we become a better, more manageable, easier fit to be used by the Lord and do what he's called us to do. And that's what 21 Easy is about. So let me continue on the acrostic this morning. Let's review the letter E. If Jesus is offering this easier yoke, if Jesus personifies true wisdom that we can live to help other people, what is this 21 Easy? What is this principle? Well, I believe it contains four things. The letter E means that we become people who edify others. Now, you and I both know it is easy to be critical. It is easy to be the Debbie Downer or the Donnie Downer. Sorry, we have Dons and Debbies, so I apologize. I'm just using them out of my head. We tend to be people who are more like Eeyore. No matter how dark it gets, you know, we have this innate ability to still pull down the shades. And God has not called us to be children of darkness. He has called us to be children of light. And when you understand the concept of light, we are bringing light to the dark world around us, and we are reflecting the light of Christ that is already in us through the Spirit of God. The sin that makes the bushel basket that covers that must be abandoned so our light can shine. And when our light shines, let me tell you, we will become more encouraging to other people than discouraging. Look, everybody can discourage about everything. All you got to do is watch TV for an hour on the news channels, and you can discourage about everything. I'm so amazed at some of the insanity and the weirdness and the complexity of the socialist and communist thinking that is trying to pervade in the society. And yet I realize that our God does not change. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And what God has called us to do then, now, and what's upcoming is to encourage people to live for the Lord, to do what is right, when they are down to help pick them up, when they have sinned, to encourage them to get it right with God. Everyone needs a helping hand. No one needs more hurt. And God's called us to edify. Letter A, this easy way of living, if you will. We are going to admonish others. Now, there are times, and I used the illustration last week of the old auntie shaking her finger warning us, don't you kids do that. And I don't believe God's word employs the admonishment in this factor. I think what we see is a reminder that God has helpful solutions. One of the things I learned early in my teaching career was a school administrator that taught me my first 2 years of teaching. He came and observed in my classroom and he said, Dave, he said, here's a good piece of treasure for a teacher's toolbox. He said, if you have to punish or discipline a student, don't stop only with the punishment. You must also teach them how to do it right the next time so you don't keep dealing with the same offense. Because he said, if they don't learn that, then the misery is theirs. But you cannot continue to let the misery be yours if you don't provide a solution. Isn't God's word filled with solutions? I mean, God's word has the solution for every challenge of life. Well, Pastor, my area is gray. So is mine, getting more so by the week. The truth of the matter is, God's word does not change, and in principle, no matter what the situation is, God makes, through overt text or through principled teaching, an avenue to find a solution for all of life's problems, no matter what they are. And by the way, remember, most of life's problems could be really easily settled if we would just come back to an adherence of the Ten Commandments. Most of the things that I deal with in military chaplaincy, most of the challenges that we deal with in counseling with law enforcement and people in uniform positions will often come back to the same areas where I tell people constantly, if we would live the Ten Commandments in the United States of America, we would look like the Andy Griffith Show again. But you know we're far from that. So what do? We admonish one another. We use helpful solutions, gentle reminders. We do it in love. We do it in humility. We do it in meekness. We do not merely bring vindictive words. Let's use helpful solutions. God's a problem solver. So let's focus on the problem solver more than we ever focus only on the problem. Because God doeth all things well. That means he brings solutions. Letter S, James 3:17 says that the wisdom from above is easy to be entreated. There is an instruction toward the persuasion to follow the word of God. Jesus is the embodied living word of God, and the scriptures are the embodied written word of God. And by the way, remember what the scripture teaches, that the word of God, as the apostle said in Hebrews, is quick, it's alive. Now, it doesn't have a heartbeat like the fish we caught yesterday, but it does have a way to change you because it is alive. It's not dead rhetoric. It's living principles that we use. So letter S, I know many of you are guessing because you had the week to do it. It's the word supplicate. If we're going to take on Jesus' easy yoke, if we're going to have wisdom that is easy to be entreated, then we're going to have to start asking God to change us. Now, everyone in this room has a common denominator. We're sinners. But we have a Savior who offers solutions. And those solutions often come when we will go to God and cast all our care upon him, as Peter teaches, because we begin to understand that he cares for us. Think about it. When's the last time you encountered a difficulty and you really prayed about it and you really prayed about them, and instead of having a problem, you helped and bring a problem solving to the matter? One thing we're really good at is what I remember a fellow assistant pastor, one of the churches that I served in before working here. I was the associate pastor of the church. There were four of us on the pastoral staff, and one of the other assistant pastors had this uncanny knack of when someone in the church was maybe in sin or needed counseling or was going through a disciplinary issue, it was a much bigger ministry. And so the four of us were meeting one morning in a pastoral meeting, and pastor brought something up, and then he asked for me to pray, and then asked for this other person to pray. And I still remember this, and it's because the way I was taught by my pastors, Lord, bring them to a place of contrition, help them to see their sin. But God, use us to help them, to encourage them. Use the word of God in their life to bring them back to full strength so they can go forward for the King. Not the next prayer. I had my head bowed, my eyes closed, and I remember looking up and looking over at him with my eyes wide open. Father in heaven, I pray that you will make them miserable. I pray that you will take them down to the lowest depths. I pray that you will make their life utter hell. I pray that you would... I'm like, dude, you're scaring me. Now, we understand that in certain of the Psalms, David was employing prayer toward the hurt of enemies. But David never prayed only for their destruction without God's guidance. We have to be very careful of that, okay? We don't want to take Eeyore into the prayer closet. Lord, I know things are really bad. I know they're going to get worse. I'm just here to tell you, I can't take it anymore. That's not the kind of prayer God is looking for from his children. Let me share with you very simply. Supplication is petition. Intercession is petition in a third person. When we supplicate to God, I love what John R. Rice used to say, prayer is asking. And it's true. Prayer is asking. But when we talk about intercession, we're talking about in a third person, we are praying on behalf of someone else and the situation they are facing. So you have to remember that supplication is simple prayer when we are coming to God with petitions, with requests, with our hurts, our cares. David said, I poured out my complaint before him. But David wasn't being arrogant. Well, God, you didn't do this for me, so I'm not going to do that for you. You say, wow, I would never approach the Lord like that. You'd be surprised how many do. And I think sometimes we all find ourselves in a situation where we're growing closer to that than to the contrition prayer of, Lord, have mercy on me, I'm a sinner. That was the difference between a publican and a Pharisee. How could Jesus declare his yoke to be easy? Look at the life he lived. Look at the ridicule, the scorn, the agony, the hurt. He never had a home of his own. He rarely slept in the same place. We would have labeled him more homeless than we would have as being someone who came as a king should come. How could Jesus' yoke actually be easier in a world that wants to follow the science instead of the Savior? I'll tell you how. All you have to do is give a simple reading to the Gospels, and you will find how much time Jesus spent with his Father. Because with God, we are not homeless. With God, we are never alone. With God, we are not a minority. With God, we are more than conquerors. And Jesus Christ employed prayer into virtually every part of his life. And I say virtually because I don't know, because there were so many books that could have been written that the books in the world couldn't contain it. But I do know that in every situation in the Word of God that's recorded, he employed prayer, supplication to his Father. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Look how much time Jesus spent with his Father. And then look how little time in our Christian walks we spend with the Father, and we wonder why the way seems so rough and hard. Jesus did say, nothing is impossible with God. Jesus reminded us that nothing is impossible if it is with the Lord. FollowGod.com, one of our church members sent me this morning a graphic from it, and FollowGod.com put up a picture that says, my day is better when I talk to Christ first. Don't look at the news first. Don't check stocks first. Don't look at texts first or emails. Go to God first. You say, Pastor, will that simple thing actually make a difference in my life? You bet it will. Because God has promised that if we will make him preeminent, that he will bless. He will grant mercy. Otherwise, we eat the fruit of our own way, as the wisest man who lived outside of Christ said. We are often eaten up with lethargy. We're often eaten up with envy. Believers are often eaten up with competition. And by the way, I still believe that the very worst thing that destroys good manners and lifestyles is bitterness. Christians are eaten up with bitterness. They're bitter about their past. They're bitter of how they were treated. They were bitter because they were mishandled. They're bitter because of this and that. They're bitter because of the government, the way that things are going. Listen to me. You got to keep tender. Don't get bitter. Be tender. Have a heart of flesh. Have a soft heart. Have a pliable heart that God can work in. And I'm telling you, if you will edify others, if you will admonish with solution, and if you will bring all of your cares to God, it will go much better for you.
Get back to your prayer walk. Get back in your prayer closet. Life is easier when we're on our knees in prayer than when we're attempting it alone in our own power and under our own energy. Look at the passage in James. This wisdom that is from above is easy to be entreated. It's just full of good stuff. Can I say that? It's just full of good stuff, including a healthy prayer walk. If your prayer walk has been anemic with the Lord, get back to it. Someone once said, you can begin a exercise or a diet plan that will change who you are even in 7 days. By the way, make it 14 days, 2 weeks, make it 21, make it 28. You can change who you are in 30 days. God can change you right now. When you begin to surrender to Him and begin to exercise this spiritual discipline daily, oh, I grant you, I promise you, Satan's going to lie to you. He'll tell you to give up. He'll tell you, what's the use of getting back right with God again and again and again? It's just rhetoric. God's not listening to you. Oh, yes, He is. It wasn't one of the apostles that brought up the 70 times 7 concept of forgiveness. It was the Savior Himself. And that proves to me that He's ready to meet you in the morning. He's ready to talk to you as you talk to Him. He talks to you through His Word. You talk to Him in prayer. Get back to your prayer life. Quit sweating it. Quit fretting it. Quit worrying about it. Quit stewing over it. And start praying. Supplication. And by the way, if you listen to the devil's deceit and many of his followers in high places of our nation are doing it, it will always be a bait and switch trick tactic that will end up being like an old western town with the big false fronts. I remember one pastor used to talk about the dangers of alcohol. And he would say, you go into that place and it's all decorated up and they have their advertisements and everybody's having a great time. And I love what he called it, because he called it the leap in and limp out tavern. Because that's what happens. They leap in and they limp out. God did not mean for us to live that way. God wants us to go forward. And when Satan lies to us and says, America's gone, the world's solutions are no longer available, what's the point? We get back up. We refuse that deceit and we go forward. The Gaither Vocal Band used to sing a song called Build an Ark. And even if it comes to the point where they try to take us down, we're going to build an ark for our family. We're going to build an ark for our church. We're going to build an ark and try to help people in our community. We're just going to keep doing what we're supposed to be doing. Don't let the world squeeze you into their mold. Let the Scriptures squeeze you into the image of Jesus Christ. His yoke is easy. And all of this can only come about with letter Y. Because, ladies and gentlemen, once we yield to Him, the difference is already in progress. When you look at the passages I've written here, most of the time we see the word yield is by the Apostle Paul to the church seated right in the middle of the Roman Empire, the church in Rome. I'm not talking about the Roman Catholic Church. I'm talking about the first church that was employed there was a living, Bible-believing, strong, gospel-preaching church in the heart of the empire. And by the way, if you think America's nuts, the Roman Empire was already in decline, utter perversion, crazy insanity. It was a mess. I mean, killing people outright for the cause of Christ. Not just messing with them, they were outright killing them and destroying them. And by the way, when the book of Romans is written, it's not written during a peaceable time. There is no peace to the wicked. But God says peace can reign in our hearts. And that's why Christians, even if we've had to run from the government, even if we've had to run from those who would try to take our lives, or even if we've had to stand and combat it and sail straight into the storm, whether we flee or fight, depending on the situation, both are correct. They can be. But let me tell you, when we yield to the Lord, see the verse? See the statements? Yield yourselves unto God. Because whoever you yield to as servants to obey, you will become servants to what or who you choose to yield. Now, without taking time to read the passage, my hope is that you will do it. But the challenge of the Apostle Paul is, yield your members as servants to righteousness. Everybody in this room knows the difference between evil and righteous. Everybody watching, you understand the difference between evil and right. So the realization of the passage is that we are yielding to this. This is the easy yoke. This is the easy to be entreated. We are persuaded that this is the right way. This is the way that God equips to help us to be fit for the Master's use. The word yield here in the Greek means to give way by recommendation based on information received and leading to a standing by our conviction in our lifestyle. Remember what I said last week? The Apostle Paul, having done all to stand. Where does that come from? Hey, how come that person, how come they're so strong in their faith and I seem to struggle every day? Because the 21 easy brought into your life, it's not that it's easy without any challenges. It's that Jesus' yoke is easy when we choose to obey Him over us. To give way by recommendation based on our information that we have received, leading to standing by conviction in our lifestyle. We give way. We proceed. We give a little caution at the corner when we see the yield sign. We look just to be sure at the railroad track, because there may not be lights, but the yield sign is there. And when that train comes rumbling through, stay off the track. It squishes you like a bug. And there's no getting out of it. So in order to keep safe, God says, yield to me. The way of God, either to yield to self and to secularism, or yield to the Savior and Scripture. That's the two choices we have. You see, one way is natural. It's natural because of our rebellion and stubbornness. Well, Reverend, I don't think it's proper for you to say that about me. Well, your great-grandpappy Adam and your great-grandmammy Eve were the exact same way we are. No getting out of it. So one way is a stubbornness and a rebellion based upon deceit. But one way is spiritual, by obedience, by humility, based on divine intervention. God working in us, Christ in us, the hope of glory. I challenge you today, choose to yield to God's way. Shake off your own and let it begin today. You say, Pastor, though, what do I do if I stumble tomorrow? Get back up and yield to God again. But I've been trying this and I seem to stumble every day. Keep doing it. The key deceit that Lucifer destroys a lot of good people with is quitting. I tried it for years. It didn't work for me. Well, maybe you need to ask yourself if you are indeed in Christ. Because if a person is in Christ, they are a new creation. They're a new creature. Old things are passed away. Now, maybe not all at the same time. Now, in Christ, we are dead to sin. We stand positionally right with Him. We are justified, but we now have a lifetime of what I call practical sanctification that has to happen. And that only happens when we yield ourselves. And the best way to yield is to take on the yoke, the easy yoke that Jesus offers. Every day when you pray, there should be four ingredients of your prayer based on the model prayer or the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Praise the Lord. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You ought to praise God every time you pray. When the passage says, forgive us our debts, even as we forgive those who are indebted to us, the understanding is that you should repent every time you come to the Lord in prayer. You say, wait a minute, when do I get to supplicate? Hold on. God has an order and a way he wants us to do things. Praise God, repent to God, then he says, and Jesus in his prayer says, give us this day our daily bread. That's when you supplicate. That's when you ask. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Don't you see how when we pray, it should end with yielding ourselves and our ways to his? Lead us not into temptation. We're yielding our way to his. Deliver us from evil. We're yielding our way to his. For thine is the kingdom. There's a recognition in the yielding that God's kingdom is a right kingdom, as Daniel said. An eternal, divine kingdom. And it's the right way for us. He's the source of the power. He is the Prince of glory. He deserves all the glory. And that's what yielding to him does. It takes the glory off of us and it gives it back to him. Remember how John the Baptist described it when he saw Jesus and he said, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. When people came and said, we thought you were him, John the Baptist said, no, he must increase, I must decrease. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to remind you what Bonhoeffer said. Only the man who follows the command of Jesus single-mindedly and unresistingly lets his yoke rest upon him, finds his burden easy, and under its gentle pressure receives the power to persevere in the right way. Because the command of Jesus is hard. It is unutterably hard for those who try to resist it. But for those who willingly submit, the yoke is easy and the burden is light. You see, everyone, what is Jesus asking of us? Well, what he asks of us, of each one of us, is to be able and willing to take up what we might call the joyful burden of discipleship. How's your prayer walk been with the Lord? How's your day's ending as compared to how they're beginning? You might have a rough week ahead. Many times we'll face challenges in the week. I talked to someone in law enforcement yesterday and they were saying, let me get to my office first so I can see how the day will develop. I said, oh man, I fully understand that. Because you just don't know what's going to happen. Good or bad, that's not the issue. Instead of focusing on the problem, we focus on the problem solver. And that's why this graphic I had last week is still pertinent today. You start your day with Jesus, you stay your day with Jesus, and you end your day with Jesus. Because his yoke is easy, and his burden is light. 21 easy. This is the wisdom that is from above. Easy to be entreated. As you make your choices today, I encourage you to choose wisely, because you will live with the choices you make. Choose Christ. Father in heaven, we've opened the Word of God together, these simple principles from these words that we've looked at. And I've tried to give God's people what I believe you taught me from the two words and the definitions and the study of it. This 21 easy way. Father, would you help us to employ this into our lives by giving ourselves to you? The nature of God never changes. The Word of God never changes. And the need of man to receive our Lord never changes. Help us to recognize and to relish in our unchanging God, knowing that He can help us to stand in the tough times, that we can be confident in the Lord, that we can grow in grace, and that we can get back up when life and sin knocks us down. Help us to be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might by employing this Bible principle. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. This morning, not only in the 4-minute video that you watched, but also in the sermon itself, you have been invited to come to Jesus Christ if you have not yet received Him as your Savior. To come to Christ will make the difference in your life, not just for time, but for eternity. If you are not yet a believer, trust Christ today. But if you're here and you are a believer, and Satan's been chucking darts at you and throwing those shots and that ammo of deceit your way, it's time to employ the shield of faith, the breastplate of righteousness, our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, our helmet of salvation. If you're here today, whether you're a believer or if you are still yet without Christ, in just a moment, a graphic will come up for those who are watching on live stream. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed here in the auditorium. I will be down front. If I could bring you and invite you to meet Jesus as your Savior, I would love to do that. To become a child of the King is to be safe forever in God's hand. If you are a Christian here today and God has spoken to you about one of these areas, being an encourager, learning to admonish towards solutions, and offering God's help through His Word to others, may I challenge you with that? Would you walk with God? How's your prayer walk? Does it need a shot of spiritual B12? Do you need to come back and begin praying about it? How about your yieldedness to the Lord? Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, His servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Choose wisely, because you will live with that choice. Father, speak to our hearts in this invitation. Teach us from God's Word, in Jesus' name. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. No one's leaving or looking around. As the instrument plays, if God's spoken to your heart, let us help you better Christian to the Lord. The altar is open. You come today.
You may be seated just for a moment as we let our live stream family exit. We pray that God will give them a wonderful Lord's Day. And just a reminder, our next message in our Time is at Hand series on eschatology or future events, we'll be talking about the second part of the rewards message that we began. And so you'll want to be here for that. We have handouts for those as well. The gym model remodeling is continuing over in the kitchen. And if you haven't had a chance, get a chance to go over there and take a look. New countertops look great. We're going to be getting more things, and we thank you for your giving. It's time to employ what you gave, and we're working on it now. We're going to have what I'm calling a smart GPS this evening after the PM service. So this is kind of an all hands. We're going to keep everybody together. And what we need you to do is bring names and addresses of people you would like us to invite for our upcoming 9/11 ceremony that will take place on Sunday the 12th. And so at 10 o'clock in the morning, we'll be doing that. That's a big day. Again, just a reminder, we signed up another new student this week for Emmanuel Christian School. Be praying and asking God to help people to see the need for Christian school education. Tomorrow, men, you're going to breakfast. We are going to breakfast at Matt's at 8 o'clock. And so be at Matt's at 8 o'clock, and someone will be there a few minutes early and try to get a couple tables saved. And so don't forget to join the men tomorrow morning. Next Sunday night is our Sweet Corn Fellowship. This is an annual party that we have. It will be in conjunction with our quarterly business meeting and the evening service. You say, Pastor, how are you going to do that in an hour? Just watch and behold. It can happen. Primetimers, we are so excited to be going up to the Grand Hotel on Monday the 23rd. We would love to have all of our primetimers join us. We have also invited all of our leadership team and all of our staff to join us. If you would like to go and you haven't signed up yet, check with Pastor Smith. Be praying for our college kids, both from our church and from the Camp Kobiak summer staff. Pray for them as they're all returning to the various colleges, and pray for the fall semester. Pray for our young people to love God and to live for God. Again, our parent meeting is on Tuesday the 24th at 6 o'clock. We're also going to be having our midweek service that night at 7, just a reminder for you. And then the baby shower for Erica is coming up, and we've got babies abounding around here, and soon we'll see new moms and babies, and so be praying for Erica. This shower is on the 27th at 6, I believe, and so be here if you can. The missions conference. I've been praying for this every day now, and praying for the missionaries, praying for God's people, giving. We have two new churches in the conference this year. It'll be a great 2 weeks, one for us. So think about that and be praying now on giving to the missionaries. And then don't forget on Sunday the 12th, this is now on our church website. So when you tell people, just go to the church website. They can see the invitation right there. This will be a great day as we come together to remember the 20th anniversary of that horrific day. The reason it will be great is because there will be many uniforms. You will be there, many of us who remember what we were doing and where we were that fateful day. And we cannot forget that as proud Americans. And so we invite you to be here that day. I don't care what they're saying out there in the weird world. We are proud Americans, and we will remember the sacrifices that were given by people who never even knew on that horrible morning. So you join us, and that'll be a wonderful time. If you've thought about sponsoring a student, one of our live stream families last week was watching the service. And this week they contacted us and said, we believe God would have us to sponsor a student this year. And that was a great blessing coming from live stream families. And so no matter who you are, if you're willing to help, that's a great blessing for our young people and for our Christian school. We hope you have a great day today. And no matter where you're at, you walk with God, and it'll be a wonderful day.